watch 100 million hours of video every day. This came out in the most recent filing for Facebook. And I think right behind Facebook, of course, there's Snapchat, which may not be, I guess, extremely popular in this part of the world, but it's very popular in the United States among millennials. When I was in high school, and I learned in sort of the very beginning of journalism, this was sort of like the pyramid here: presence, credibility, identity, reputation, authority, influence. That's something that stayed with me. I would say basically that there's one thing that's missing here, and it's like impact. But I say missing because if you have this, even to some degree, I think there's the potential for impacting people, not just influencing people. Influence is one thing, you can grow your influence, but when you use your influence for something great, for something just sort of much higher than yourself, I think you begin to impact individuals. So with that in mind, I want to go ahead and bring up the rest of our panel. I'm going to bring up Rasha Goel from Los Angeles. She is an entertainer, TV host, an Emmy-nominated producer and actress, and he did an amazing job at the gala last night. Bayon Tall, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Bayon, my apologies, Bayon. Bayon Tall, senior advisor, media institute, and former director general for the Jordan Radio and TV and Foreign Press Secretary to His Majesty, King Abdullah Jordan. Next, Jamie Virgin, actually Dr. Jamie Virgin, and he is a chief editor of the American Scientist, director of science communications and publications in the United States. And I think that sort of rounds out our panel. So we're going to go ahead and get started here with Rasha, who has a really great presentation here to start off. I think it's something that's going to really endear it to the crowd here. Something that just sort of what we've been talking about the last 2 weeks. But I'll let her go ahead and do this. So Rasha, take it away.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you. It's such a pleasure to be here amongst all of you, creative, intelligent, and just communication community. I come from a journalistic background, and actually to start off, I'd like to share something with you.
Time period in American history, in a place that was almost like the Amazon. It was untouched, uncharted territory. And so we were going to push ourselves to the limit in these real locations and elements. So when you're sort of reenacting somebody's journey as they've been mauled by a bear trying to survive, you naturally get into character and you naturally, things happen. And for example, the bison liver was only because it just didn't look real. The thing that they gave me didn't look real. And if you're going to go for something like this, you go to the absolute extremes to try to create something beautiful and artistic and poetic. And that's the whole point of making movies, is pushing yourself to the limits, of course, within a safe context, but try things you've never tried before and try to make something original and different.
The reason I brought that specific bite to you guys from our recent interview with him is because there were two things that really resonated with me from that interview. Two words that came to mind: authenticity and accountability. Now, Leo is an actor, so he uses his filmmaking and his talent to deliver his authenticity to make sure that when you leave the theater, you understand his character and you get the realism of it. But at the same time, he is accountable for that. He is responsible for creating that image. So as a broadcast journalist, that is my job, to be accountable and to create authenticity for my audiences, for my viewers who look at my storytelling, and that too in a compelling way. For me, I kind of actually look at the media section from a broadcast perspective, and I divide it up into two sections, news and entertainment. Now, news for me is the factual information that you receive that affects you as a citizen, as an individual, on the local, national, and international level. Entertainment is what we all need in our daily lives to get away from the daily ruts of life. So that could be obtained through television, through movies, through video games, to animation, anything that kind of works for you and just takes you away from the daily ruts of life. But both together are very, very powerful. And for me, I feel that media is a very, very powerful tool. And being a local as well as an international correspondent, this tool actually has helped me in providing so many stories. And one way I want to just share with all of you, because it's been so interesting for me to sit here, as many of you come from different backgrounds and in the communications realm, is that media really helps change lives. And one story that sticks into my mind on the international level was the 2012 Delhi rape case that happened in India. There was a young woman who was gang raped by six men on a driving bus. And I thought what was so impactful about that story is that story became an international news story because of the media. Had the media not brought that story to the attention of the people, that young victim and her family would not have received justice. And even more than that, the media helped bring this topic that has been a suppressed topic in a community where it needed to be talked about. And I just feel that the media was so empowering in that it helped this country really bring to the forefront a topic that needs to be discussed, and now women have a voice on that. So that's where, for me, the media is a very powerful tool, but I understand in different communities there's that challenge that comes up now that the media is being kind of used in a negative and a positive way. And that kind of takes me into my next slide, because as a journalist, Sean mentioned there's been the traditional media. I have grown up in traditional news. Go to the field, get the facts, get your resources, tell the story. But with social media, it has really changed the news world. What's happened is that people now have so many different places to go to. And I just would like to share some statistics with you, done by the University of Oxford Reuters Institute. They found, after researching 12 countries, that Facebook, YouTube, WhatsApp, Twitter, and Google are used for news. And young viewers actually are using Instagram, Snapchat, and Tumblr for their news. And then when you actually look at Twitter and Facebook, Twitter kind of trends to be more on the serious side. So they lean towards news, valid news such as BBC and New York Times, whereas Facebook tends to favor more of the lifestyle and entertainment news such as Playbuzz, The Huffington Post, oops, and BuzzFeed. But again, my point here as a journalist is that there is so much information that's being relayed out there. We are constantly saturated, as one of the other panelists said, with noise. And how do you decipher which of this noise is true and which one of it is not? And to use that example, I think, especially being American, we are at a very crucial point right now with the U.S. presidential election. How many of you have actually formulated an opinion about Mr. Donald Trump based on social media? How many of you use Twitter here? Show of hands. Okay, what about Facebook? All right, so you have seen all the crazy shenanigans that Mr. Trump has used with social media. Now, he's really changed the face of politics. And I say that because for the first time, I think in the U.S. presidential election, we are seeing a candidate really go to social media to promote themselves. It's been done before where, President Obama has used social media to communicate with the public, but as far as an election, His running mates are basically using television advertisements. They're using radio, they're using traditional media to advertise themselves and to rebut against him. But Trump...